Hello, I'm Sabine O'Hara, Dean of the University of the District of Columbia's College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences, and host of the television and internet program series, Causes. Are agriculture and food production a viable concept as a means of sustainability in our urban neighborhoods? Is it possible to grow enough healthy food with the available land in our urban centers to meet the demands of an even increasing urban population? Joining me on this edition of Causes are two people who say yes to both questions and will explore the reasons behind their viewpoint. Steve Moore is director of the Sustainable Food Systems Program in the Department of Environmental Studies at Elon University in North Carolina. And Che Axum is director of the Center for Urban Agriculture and Gardening Education in the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences here at the University of the District of Columbia. Welcome, Steve and Che.
Pleasure.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
Urban agriculture and sustainable agriculture. Are those contradictions, or can food be grown in a sustainable manner in urban centers?
I think the answer to that is certainly yes. You know, you have to have food where the people are. And over history and time, we see that the integration of people, food, built design can all happen.
Mm-hmm. So, but it's not your usual approach, right? Or maybe we've lost it. It used to be the usual approach, but maybe we've lost it.
It was the usual approach. Mm-hmm. And as things got segmented out in our societies and people migrated around, then places became designated for production of food and others for living, but not integrated.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So how do we get the integration back? We're doing a lot of things here in DC to try and make that happen, right? To bring food production back into urban neighborhoods and back to people who live in these neighborhoods.
Well, we are, and there's a gentleman by the name of John Jevons who is an associate of Steve's, and one of the things that John always says is that we have become a food illiterate society, mm-hmm. farming illiterate society. Changing that around is one of the challenges to getting folks to understand that, you know, we can grow food, you can grow food. Even if you have a balcony, you can grow lettuce or carrots in your balcony. Just changing that whole thought, because we have so disconnected, and it only takes one generation to lose that knowledge about growing food. So changing that back is the challenge, and that's the direction that we need to take.
Yeah, I mean, we've had people out at the farm, at the research farm we operate out in Beltsville, and not just young people either, but adults who say, wow, this is what tomatoes look like when they grow, right? Because they had never seen it. Food comes from the supermarket, comes from the store, but never seen how it actually grows. That's a huge disconnect.
It is. It really is. And that's part of that disconnect from nature, too. You know, 10,000 years ago, when we moved towards agriculture as a species, we started isolating ourselves from the natural world. And I find it very fascinating that as we enter this new era, maybe the third great transition after agriculture mm-hmm. and industrial transitions, that we start rethinking our place in the natural world. And wouldn't it be fun if food that took us away last time brings us back to an mm-hmm. understanding of the natural world, where we really care about the earth, water, land, and the other creatures that mm-hmm. live on the earth?
Now, you say, Steve, in some of your own work, that we really have to be intentional about being sustainable and about making our food system sustainable. So what are some of the ways of doing that?
Well, I think that when we look to the future, Sabine, we often want to do better, and that's always a good thing, but having a goal, a vision of where we want to be is really important. So growing food, we certainly want to make sure that we don't use more water than can be replenished, whatever that means wherever you live. We should not use more energy than we can use renewable or put into the system. And we can't really import nutrients to another area to make one area rich and the other area poor. Mm-hmm. So we have to really focus on those means within the social context that people find themselves within mm-hmm. communities.
So food systems, just like nature, there are certainly dimensions to it that are global, but most of it is really intensely local. Things that work one place won't work another place. So
yes, we can understand what we have to do to balance it, but how that's achieved will be completely community by community, elegant solutions.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the exciting part. It allows empowers people to engage themselves in their own community development with their own identity.
So sustainability, you said we need to harvest more energy than what we put in, ideally, and we don't really do that very much, right? A big part of the energy, the net energy balance that makes it negative, where we take we put more in than what we actually get. A big part of that is transportation, isn't it?
It is, and the other big segment is nitrogen fertilizers.
Uh-huh.
So the energy equation is for every calorie we get to consume, we spend 13 calories of fossil fuel. That's very poor banking if you only have so much fossil fuel.
Yeah. We always learn about the big three, right? In agriculture, NPK, nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. Nothing much happens without those, and it's
right.
Especially the nitrogen that is a big input into the system. And I think, you know, some of our viewers may not know that most of what we put into that system in form of nitrogen comes from fossil fuels.
It does.
And is made from fossil fuels. We are exploring very different ways of putting nitrogen and carbon, for that matter, and back into the system. So tell us a little bit how that works.
Well, one of the things that I'm really excited about on the farm and what we're doing at Merkirk is using cover crops to add nitrogen back to the soil. Because if you really look at it, just over our heads right now, there's a tremendous amount of nitrogen. You can't see it, but it's there. And capturing that nitrogen into the system, we have plants that capture that nitrogen. We can grow these plants as cover crops. They can fix this nitrogen, get it in their leaves, and fix it in their roots, and take this nitrogen from the air. That free nitrogen is very important. So we can do more of that and use more of that at the farm and even the urban gardens. I mean, all mm-hmm. the legume crops like clover and vetch and pea crops, all these crops fix nitrogen. They take this free nitrogen from the air, fix it in their leaves, and goes down to the roots, and it's there.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't really beat that. You cannot really beat that. It's absolutely a necessity as far as sustainability is concerned.
And, of course, most of what's in our atmosphere is actually nitrogen.
Right? It is.
People may
it
think
is.
Of the oxygen because we need it to breathe,
yeah.
but really the main bulk of it is
and that's amazing.
Is nitrogen.
It's, it's a powerful solution.
So it's amazing that we haven't done more of that, right, using plants that are able to fix it from the atmosphere, put it right back.
Well, you
into
know, a long
system.
Time ago, they used to do a lot more of that.
Even in the Greek, classical Greek era, they were using legumes to improve. Where they got in trouble was as population increased, they needed more food crops.
Uh-huh.
And so they knew what to do, but they gave that up in lieu of immediately feeding their population and then let go of the sustainability.
Mm-hmm.
And Plato had a great, compelling passage about the problems that would ensue, and indeed it did, the demise of the countryside and then eventually the civilization.
Mm. So it's oftentimes the case, right? We know what to do, but
political will or
trying to take shortcuts, right?
Right, so, right.
And there we go. You stress a lot, I mean, both of you in your work, you stress a lot the importance of soil health. So say a little bit more about that, Steve. Soil health, what is it based on?
There's three basic components of soil health, and that is biological activity, nutrient availability, and soil structure.
Mm-hmm.
And all three of them work interconnectedly to support and strengthen each other. And when you have all three, then you have the healthiest possible soil. And I think we forget as we walk over the soil and run around on a playground or wherever we are, that in every ounce of healthy soil, which would just barely fit in the palm of your hand, that there's more live organisms than there are people on the planet right now.
Wow.
And so, you know, when we start seeing the biological activity below the ground as much as we see it above, then probably we'll be a pretty wise civilization.
Wow. But that's, you know, that's amazing.
It's all about education.
So many organisms, microorganisms, in a little bit of soil that fits into your hand.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Reminds me a little bit of that Dr. Seuss book, Horton Hears the Who, you know, where the who people are these tiny little ones that you don't see them, and they live on the speck of a clover. So there's so much activity going on in nature that is not visible to the human eye, and so therefore we kind of ignore it, right? Mm-hmm. Soil health in urban neighborhoods, Che, how do people do it? I mean, it seems tough enough to reintroduce the tradition of growing your own food, growing your own vegetables. Well, but then to make the connection to the soil, it seems yet another step to remember.
Well, you know, I usually kind of phrase it like this. I mean, just the word soil comes from the Latin word solium, S-O-L-I-U-M, which mm-hmm. means the foundation on that upon which something is built.
Mm-hmm.
So if you really look at it from that context, soil is the foundation of health and life. And so the healthier we can get our souls, the healthier we can be. If we can create healthy soils, we can create healthy plants. If we can create healthy plants, we can create healthy people.
Yeah.
It's very simple.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever we have to do to really make that soil healthy, you know, should be a process that we can do, so we could eliminate, you know, a lot of health problems and a lot of things like that. If we can create healthy soil, get the soil healthy, get the plants healthy, and then get the people healthy.
Say some more about that, because it seems to me that so many times we think about healthy food more in terms of how we prepare it, right? Do we put a lot of salt in it? Do we put a lot of sugar and fat in it? Or do we eat it more raw? But you're saying it really starts way before that.
It starts at the pharmacy, not pharmacy. It starts at that pharmacy.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a group of high school and middle school folks come out this past week, and I told them, I said, look, unfortunately, this is where health starts. It doesn't help start at some of these other places that you might think, maybe at the doctor's office or the drugstore. It starts right here at the farm, getting the food grown correctly, getting the nutrient density correct in the food.
Mm-hmm.
And then if we can really do that successfully, then we can be healthy. But the food starts at the pharmacy, pharmacy.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Nutrient density. There seems to be growing awareness that the food we buy today, the food we eat today, is not the same food that we bought maybe 20 years ago, right? It has changed. You did some research on that, Steve. How has it changed?
We tracked five different things that were of interest: lettuce, kale, onions, potatoes, and one other thing. And we noticed that overall there was a 25% decline in the nutrient quality.
Wow.
31% in protein alone. So the 59% in iron. It's no wonder that we are a nation of supplements and diseases, because this food is fairly weak.
And that happened in a fairly short period of time.
20 years.
20 years, we lost 25% of the nutrient value of our food. Wow.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty shocking. Any idea where that comes from?
What's probably where it didn't come from, and that was from, as Che says, from the healthy, biologically soil that supports good plant growth and healthy plants.
So we've been depleting the quality of the soil, and therefore are depleting the quality of the food. What are some of the things that we've done to our soils that have depleted them?
Well, you know, one of the things, there are a couple of reasons why these crops have gone down in the nutrient density. And two things that really bring to mind to me what has happened, and there's been some research, peer-reviewed research papers that support this, is that there's been a dilution effect.
Uh-huh.
There's been a dilution effect caused by using the wrong type of fertilizers to grow foods, which, like you said earlier, high in N, P, and K. flooding systems with that, and then that precludes some of the important other elements like calcium and boron and some of these other elements getting up in the plant because you have too much of those three things. And also in the breeding process of crops sometimes, when you're breeding for maybe stem vigor or glossiness or big leaf canopy, this breeding process sometimes in the breeding process when you're doing the crosses, some of the important things like protein or calcium density or other or boron or magnesium, some of these things are kind of left behind as you strive for a more yield in agriculture.
And oftentimes we also don't even grow for nutrients at all, but we not like it to look pretty, right? For color and no blemishes, no brown spots,
for commercial
and so
appeal.
Forth. Yeah, for commercial appeal. So how do we reintroduce people to that? Seems to me that's a bit of an uphill battle. Where do you start with reintroducing people to their food, to their locally grown food? Sort of one person at a time?
I think that's the way it has to be, and I think it's. I think when you eat good food, you feel different, and you're compelled to go to the next step of either acquiring good food or growing it yourself. And I think that teaching, especially young people, the taste of good food will be a compelling argument for them to move forward with that.
So it starts often with the personal health, right? How do I feel? How do I feel when I've eaten right, when I feel more energy, right? Is it possible to kind of grow your own diet or a good bit of your own diet, even when you have a small piece of land? Because, you know, people will think, well, not even a remote possibility for me because all I have is a little townhouse or a balcony or that little piece of land between the buildings where I live. Is it possible? How much land does one need to start growing food?
I would say you don't even need land.
Okay.
So, you know, you can go and buy seeds and sprout them yourself. All you need is a jar and a lid. And now you have your own fresh food that has what you need to get started. You can add to that if you have a very small closet. You could turn that into a mushroom production area and have 4 to 5 pounds of mushrooms per week for your family. So there's just thing, and that's in your house. And now you go out onto the balcony, you have other foods that you can grow to complement that.
What would you grow in that jar, Steve, if you had to pick something? Say you have very limited space, I've got a windowsill. That's about the natural light I have. What would you choose?
For a plant or for sprouts?
For plants.
For a plant. If it was a big window, I would probably have a tomato. If it was a small window, I'd probably grow one of the, I'd grow greens in there and cycle them through. Maybe even things with high density nutrition like wheatgrass and juice it.
Oh, wheatgrass. And greens like spinach, like kale, those kinds of things?
Try to hit the foods with the highest nutritional value and the least amount of pesticides. That's another thing that takes away from our health as well.
We have how many pesticides floating around now? We've lost count,
Well, the CDC did a survey, and of almost 10,000 people, every single person had residue, and the average was 13.
Wow, 13 pesticides, just in our own human bodies.
Our own tissues, right.
That's pretty scary. How do you stay away from it? We hear that a lot, of course, right, at the farm. What do I do with the pests? How do I stay away from the potato bugs and all of that?
Well, you know, for me as an agronomist and a farmer, one of the things I often have to understand is I have to have an intimate understanding of pests, their life cycle, how many life cycles they may produce, how they do produce, which plants they like, and have that understanding. And then with that knowledge, then you can go and proceed to really defend against problems. But you have to understand the pests, the temperature that they come out, the time of the year that they might come out, what time they might disappear. So, and these, you know, there's some information out about that, but you have to have that type of understanding then. And then there's some crops that you can grow too, which might not be affected by pests as much.
Like what?
Well, for example, in the brassica plant family, some of the kohlrabi plants with the dark purple skins on it like that, they're more resistant to the type of pests that attack that family than some of the other types of plants in that family. So looking at those type of things. There are a few things like that, and just leaf canopy and, you know, thickness of the leaf and things like that, the waxy coating and glossiness of some, like I said, some of the brassica plants in the kale family. They're a little bit more resistant than, say, some of the other ones that have a little more tender leaf. So you have to really have that understanding. Then you can proceed to, you know, deal with the pests much more effectively.
So where would you start if you have a very small plot of plants? Steve said he would grow a tomato plant or green.
I'm going with the superstars, the dark green leafy vegetables. And the reason why I like those, really, because for the most part, a lot of those don't take a lot of sunlight. So you can deal with maybe 6 hours of sunlight per day or 7 hours, and as opposed to some of the, when you're producing that fruit on a crop like that, you need a lot more photosynthetic energy to produce that fruit. But I'm going to probably stick with some of those leafy green vegetables, which you don't need a lot of photosynthetic energy to produce a very nutritious crop.
You know, one of the things I noticed too, both at the farm, and I've only seen pictures of what you're growing, Steve, but one of the things I notice is how dense the stuff grows, how many layers there are. So it seems to me, do we need to change how we teach people about growing food in small spaces? Because, you know, I've actually started applying some of it myself, and I don't space my cabbages as far apart anymore as I used to. I kind of bunch them up more. And is that one of the techniques to maximize space?
It does maximize space. It maximizes the amount of calories per unit area. And also, though, it, from an underground point of view, where those roots are, there's an area around each root called the rhizosphere where there's 100 times the biological activity. And the question you asked about soil health, biological activity was a key ingredient. And the plants shunt the sugars down to there, and in return, the biological organisms in the soil return nutrients in an available way. So when I crowd plants in, I'm not only getting more food for me, I'm providing more food for the organisms, creating increased diversity and stability in the soil to ward off diseases and things like that. And then on top of that, you know, you can grow, so you're growing cabbage now, it's the fall. Pretty soon you'll harvest your cabbage, and then maybe it isn't so nice out anymore, and you kind of let the garden go till spring. So right around now is a good time to start sprinkling some rye seed underneath, or some hairy vetch, or some Austrian winter field peas, and start to keep that biology of that area going, so that in the spring you have more nutrients. And things like the Austrian winter field peas will provide you with leaves of them will be similar to snap peas, if you like those in salads. So you can all through the winter have food off of that.
Are there plants that do particularly well when you bunch them together? So, you know, certain ones that thrive better when they are together?
They do, and the classic one is the three sisters of the corn, beans, and squash. And it's fun to see as science picks apart this ancient practice of multi-cropping, where they actually can pull out squash leaf extracts and realize that it has pesticide properties for the other plants, and that it provides habitat. And so you see, and from a science explores why it's been successful, and it's very fascinating.
So these are ancient practices, and they knew what they were doing.
They did indeed.
And it just took us some time to prove it.
In some of the African cultures, they actually have traditionally 12 crops in a small area that all integrate in so many ways with nitrogen cycling, pest control, enhanced qualities of fruits, including things like lycopene and tomatoes and stuff like that, all throughout systems.
We've been experimenting with some ethnic crops out at the farm. Any lessons that we've learned there, Che?
Well, yeah, we have the ethnic crops that we grow. We have Mr. Yao Afanchanto. He's the ethnic crop specialist at the farm. And growing crops like the African eggplants and peppers and waterleaf, some of the crops like the waterleaf is particularly interested in that because of seems like this crop might have a high amount of omega-3 fatty acids in it and things like that. And so the hot peppers, and there's just a whole variety of the things that not only are they, I call them climate change crops, because growing them in the city here and not shipping them from faraway places reduces the carbon footprint, but also growing these crops which have medicinal purposes and also high vitamin content. So you have a three kind of trifecta effect with growing ethnic crops.
So there is a lot we can do in very small spaces, even in the middle of a city, and do it in a way that closes the loop and that is sustainable, not just for the food, but for our bodies as well.
Absolutely. Yeah.
My guests have been Steve Moore, Director of the Sustainable Food Systems Program in the Department of Environmental Studies at Elon University in North Carolina, and Che Axum, Director of the Center for Urban Agriculture in the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. Causes is a television series from the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. As your public land-grant university, we are committed to conducting research and offering education programs that improve your quality of life and economic opportunity. In the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences, you will find academic programs that are relevant and practical. And the research-based community education programs of our five land-grant centers are making a qualitative difference in the lives of the people and organizations they serve. So you will find Causes team members like Che Axum not only teaching in the classrooms, laboratories, and architecture studios on our campuses, but also in schools, religious centers, community gardens, and farmers markets in every ward of the District of Columbia. If you would like more information, please visit our college online at www.udc.edu/causes. I am Sabine O'Hara. Thank you for watching. See you next time on Causes.